Welcome, friends. It is good to be together again and to praise the holy and living God. We give thanks that God is always present, always active, and always working for good. Our call to worship today is adapted from Psalm 84. This would be a great time to stand if you're comfortable doing so, and remaining sitting is fine too. How lovely is your dwelling place, O Lord of hosts. My heart sings for joy to the living God.
Happy are those who live in your house, ever seeing your grace.
Let us sing the hymn, How Lovely, Lord, How Lovely, and the insert in your bulletin.
Please be seated. We who desire to be faithful followers of Jesus Christ sometimes encounter stumbling blocks. When our resolve falters or our strength fails, we can turn to God for restoration and grace. We join now in a prayer of confession and renewal, followed by a time of silent prayer. Generous God, heal our lives, that we may acknowledge your wonderful deeds and offer you thanks from generation to generation. Steady our hearts and direct our dreams so that we may pursue what is right and good. Enlighten our minds that we may see the world as you see it. Awaken hope in us so that we may encourage others through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God's forgiving love is beyond measure. It is freely bestowed upon us. We are forgiven and embraced by God's mercy. Amen.
And since we are in the presence of the Lord, let's greet one another now in the peace of Christ. Well, it's a rowdy bunch. Some of you maybe are back from vacation and happy to see each other again. Welcome to each and every one of you, and in particular, welcome to anyone with whom we might be worshiping for the first time. It is wonderful to share in this time and place of worship together, both gathered in person and gathered from various places around the world, thanks to the fact that we're able to post this worship service on YouTube. I'd like, if possible, for each row to have the opportunity to circulate the welcome pad. The person sitting on the end of the row might be the person to find it. If you could take it out and put your name in there, it's really surprisingly helpful to your pastors to think back. The morning goes fast for us. We get to think back and remember who was here and pray for you. And if you are able to offer us new or updated information about how to contact you, helps us to stay in connection with one another as a church family. So thank you for taking a moment with the welcome pads. Jonathan is well. I picture him later today participating in worship when the service gets posted. The pictures I have seen are of his feet extended onto the chair, the ottoman there in front of him, the one that had surgery, wrapped in a massive bandage. He said he's been remarkably free of pain, and he's held off on starting to practice with that scooter where you rest your knee on it, and then I don't get how it works, but he thought maybe the day that his daughter was visiting with an extra dog in the house probably was not the day to start practicing on the scooter. I see that you agree. I'm delighted with the team here helping to lead worship today. We're happy to welcome again this Sunday Rachel Kim, who has just a couple weeks ago moved here to the Peninsula area so that she can be 7 minutes away from her job at the high school. So we're happy she doesn't have to commute from Irvine anymore, and we're delighted for her musical gifts being shared with us in worship. With her is Abigail Whitman, who we know and love from her childhood until now, and for her presence in the choir. And she now also a professional musician and music teacher. We're relying on her for all our vocal leadership today, and thankful for the choir members scattered throughout the congregation helping the rest of us sing. Nancy Wallace is helping lead today, bringing her gifts gained after she completed a career in business leadership. She went off to seminary and earned a Master of Divinity degree, and she thanks God. The blessing is to us. She exercises her gifts here in worship leadership, in Bible study, participation and leadership, and in spiritual growth retreat type leadership experiences. So thank you, Nancy, and thank you, Deborah Schrader, who we know and love, another musically talented, kind and generous person involved in the mission of the church in various ways and consistent in serving as a liturgist. So aren't I lucky to be sharing, and aren't we lucky sharing together with all these good people. The flowers this morning are a gift of Dave and Zoe Carney, who on August 11th, yay, congratulations, celebrated their 46th wedding anniversary. Now working on year 47. Way to go, Dave and Zoe. Yes, they are here. You can clap for them. You are lucky. Today is the fourth and final Sunday of the month. Therefore, you will get to enjoy donuts on the patio along with your coffee. If you don't have a meal plan for this evening, you could come back at 6:30 when our third service ends, or come at 5:30 to enjoy the third service and then stay for taco night. Either way, $5 a person or a maximum of $15 a family, you can join in a time of food and fellowship. Also, Susan Markey is generous this morning to be here with us after the service to take blood pressure readings for anyone who might find that service helpful. This is a complimentary service we offer once a month to try to help keep you all healthy. And so she will be in the building next door. You can go into the reception area. The blood pressure cuff is in the conference room. She keeps an eye out to see who's there and will happily talk to you about your blood pressure or any other medical concern that you want a consultation on. Because it is the last Sunday of the month, now we must force ourselves to realize that coming soon is September. Oh boy, lots of things happening. I know kids have started back in school and things will just keep gearing up, but it's a good time to review what's upcoming for the month. One thing is that on September 5th, which is a Thursday, we have the opportunity to honor and celebrate the life of Joanne Austin. Her son Will is working with me to plan a service, 11 o'clock on Thursday, September 5th, here in the sanctuary. Then the next week, and you can refer to the insert in your program for this information. You don't have to remember what I say if you take this home and put it on your refrigerator. Bible study with the book of Proverbs will meet four sessions starting on September 10th, and that's always a good time. We meet in person during the day, and the group that wants to meet in the evening meets on Zoom, so you have both options, and I'd love for you to consider taking part. On the other side is the flyer about the bereavement support group, which will start meeting here on September 12th and meet for 8 sessions. This group is professionally facilitated by a member of our church and whose career was in grief counseling. And her name is Claire Toll. She has a program and an agenda for each of those 8 sessions to help educate and encourage people. And it also, she's good at helping everyone in the room who wishes to have a chance to tell a little bit about their experience or ask questions to be comfortable doing that as well. I want to emphasize that this is not only for members of the church, but for anyone in the community. So lots of times, Jonathan and Kristen and I received the question from you all, like, oh, my neighbor's going through this loss. What can I, you know, what can I refer them to? So this is a chance. Anytime in the last couple of years, if someone has experienced the loss of someone significant to them, it would be a great gift to tell them about this group. Sometimes people, right after the loss, are too overwhelmed to be able to take part in a group, and that's why even a year later or 18 months later, you could get started on something like this and it would still be really helpful for you. Okay, those are the announcements. Now I'd like to invite the kids to come up and join me here at the front. Hey, everybody, I'm happy to see you. I've been making a list, and I thought that maybe you could help me with it. It's a list of places to pray. It's pretty long already, but I was thinking maybe I could read it to you, and then you could see if you can think of any places that we should add to the list. I got these ideas from the Bible when I noticed that different people prayed in all kinds of different places. So Here's my list. Abraham prayed in a country not his own. Moses prayed outside Pharaoh's palace in the city. Also, he prayed way out in the wilderness. Elijah prayed in the home of someone who had given him a place to stay. He was a guest in someone's home, and that's where he prayed. Hannah prayed in the temple. Nehemiah prayed while serving wine in the royal banquet hall. Jeremiah prayed in the halls of justice. Jonah prayed from inside the belly of a whale. He got swallowed, and in the whale's tummy, he prayed. Jesus liked to pray on mountains, and he prayed in a garden when he was sad and scared. The disciples tended to pray in meeting rooms. And Stephen, who was one of the disciples, prayed while people were throwing rocks at him. Peter prayed on the roof of a building, and Daniel prayed in the upper room of his house. Silas prayed while he was in jail. So what do you think we should add? Where do you like to pray, Sterling? Yes, okay, in case you didn't hear, we're getting the suggestion that praying in the airport when you have lost your chance at the first flight you were supposed to be on and you're waiting for the next one, that would be a super good time to pray. Excellent, thank you. In your backyard, great. Willa. Okay, so you're suggesting when your mom and dad tell you that there's someplace you're going that's going to be super exciting and fun, then you pray that they don't forget and make you wait till later. Is that right? Got it? Okay. Well, those are great suggestions. And now this list has gotten even longer than it was before. This list teaches me that we actually can pray anywhere. And you know that because you do that. And King Solomon believed this too. According to the Bible, Solomon built a temple to help people honor God. Nowadays, we meet in this building, and these buildings, this building and others like it, are called churches. But in Solomon's time, the building that he constructed and dedicated to God was called a temple, or sometimes it was called a house. To contrast it with the houses that people lived in, sometimes they called it the house for God's name. Well, one of Solomon's purposes in building this building was to help people remember to pray. He wanted people, wherever they were, to be able to pray to God and be heard. Solomon imagined that people could be inside the temple, or they could be outside the temple looking at it, or they could be far away just thinking about it, and it would remind them of God, and God would be attentive to their prayers. Now, when Solomon prayed, he prayed for stability and for faithfulness, but he knew people prayed for all kinds of things. And so he had a list of what people prayed for. He knew that people prayed for justice to be fulfilled, for the experience of forgiveness. They prayed for help doing the right thing. People pray for the ability to do what God wants and to serve God effectively. People pray for compassion and care when they're not feeling good. And he knew that people pray for freedom. Well, the Bible in other places from Solomon's prayer reminded me that people pray for healing, for nighttime to end and the daylight to come, for help making a decision. We pray, some people pray when they are hoping they could have a child in their family. People pray for courage. They pray for understanding. They pray for the gift of the Spirit. They prayed to be rescued and saved from disaster. They pray for so many things. And then I thought, well, what else could we add? I think we give prayers of thanksgiving because we're grateful for food and shelter and love and our families. We pray for the people we care about. We pray to trust ourselves into God's care. Is there anything else we should pray about when we're saying our prayer, which we're just about to do? If you think of something while I'm praying, just the fact that you're thinking of it is going to make it be included in the prayer. God's hearing both our thoughts and our words. Sterling?
Do you want to pray for homeless people that are on the street right now?
Okay, we'll pray for homeless people. I'm adding that to the list. Thank you. All right, here we go. Dear God, thank you for hearing our prayers, whether they are offered in gladness or in sorrow. We appreciate your attention to our lives and to our needs, and we know that you are caring for all people. We pray for the people who don't have a home to rest in, a place, a safe place to go. We pray that they would find nourishment and care, and that we, as a community, as a society, would find solutions to this problem. Guide our thoughts, our words, and our actions so that we can share your love with the world. Amen. Thank you so much, and have fun in Sunday school.
The final chapter of Ephesians uses imagery of a call to battle to instruct the people of Ephesus how to live as a community. While we often think of outside forces when we read this powerful metaphor, it can also refer to our inner world and our daily experience of letting go of things that distance us from God. Imagine how the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, shoes that ready us to proclaim peace, a shield of faith, the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit or Scripture protect and guide us as we strive to increasingly put God at the center of our lives. With this knowledge and faith, we will pray for Greg Jarvis, who completed his course in faith and has joined the Saints in Light. He was 63. We extend our condolences to Greg's dad, Larry, Greg's partner, family, and friends. We have learned from Arlene Korb's son that Arlene now rests in God's eternal arms. Arlene was a longtime member of the church. The family plans a memorial service, but we don't have the details yet. And just last night, Dick Getz joined the Saints in Light. Phyllis and Dick are also longtime members and very involved in the life of the church. Dick has been receiving hospice care, so this isn't a surprise, but it's no less sad for Phyllis and family. Louise Koch requests our prayers for Harvey Edenoff as he struggles with cancer and infection. We will also pray for Lee Browning, who is still at Torrance Memorial, as his doctors work to diagnose the illness he is grappling with. And the update on Jonathan's surgery, as you heard earlier, is that all went well and he is recovering. Certainly everything that is on our minds and hearts is in God's care. Let's join now together in prayer. All-loving God, we come before you with open hearts, grateful for our families and friends that make our lives so full of meaning and joy. We are filled with compassion and love for those on our hearts now as they navigate health challenges and for those who are now home with you. Our hearts are filled with love for those so close to us, and we thank you for all the lives we have shared. We pray also for the people and places that are suffering so much here and around the world. We grieve for the loss of life and all the suffering taking place, especially in the land where you yourself walked, where you taught us to love each other as you love us. Work in your mysterious and silent ways to reshape our hearts with your infinite love, the most powerful force there is, so that all of humanity might live lives that are at peace and secure and free. You are our hope, and we pray you lavish your wisdom in ways both small and large, removing every obstacle that keeps us from responding to your call. We ask that you comfort the Jarvis family, especially Greg's dad, Larry, and Greg's partner, and all the family and friends who need to feel your presence, especially close, especially now. We ask, too, your comfort for the Korb family as they and friends grieve Arlene's passing. We pray that they feel your loving arms holding them as they love and remember her. Please comfort Phyllis and all the family and friends of Dick. It is so hard to say goodbye, even as we know we will be reunited again in your loving arms. Magnify your loving care for Harvey and the doctors and nurses skillfully working to care for him. Be especially close to Lee and the medical professionals as they care for him and learn what is going on so they can continue providing care to him. We ask your love and peace for the family and friends of those continuing with long-term healthcare considerations, including Dave Hessick, Bunny Renholt, Ruth Yonner, Anna Trauma, Hannah Kopecka, Phyllis Sherwood, Bill Lotto, Andy Miller, Ron Jones, Joan Green, Andy Pine, Art Schneider, Mary, and Don Peterson. Thank you for the healing Jonathan is experiencing as he recovers from recent surgery. Most compassionate and loving God, hover close around the family and friends of these who are on our hearts and have them feel your love, especially now. Console them with your peace that passes understanding. We thank you for your love that never leaves us, that is the foundation of all that lives. Your hand is at work in ways we don't always know, and you surprise us in ways we could never anticipate. Guide us, comfort us, inspire us, and move through us as we reflect your love in our thoughts, our habits, our relationships, and all of our endeavors. May your kingdom truly reign here on earth. We ask these things, Holy God, trusting in the healing and hope of your Spirit. As you taught us, let us pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our appreciation for God's steadfast love and faithfulness is expressed in contributions to God's work in the world. Each week, gifts are conveyed online, in person, and in the mail. Honoring this generosity, we pray. Eternal God, as we bring forth our offerings today, we celebrate your enduring presence among us. With hearts full of gratitude, we offer these gifts as a symbol of our commitment to live lives of worship, not just within these walls, but in every moment of our existence. May our words and actions be a testament to your glory, shining forth your love and grace to all we encounter. Amen. You may be seated. Today's scripture reading comes from a theological history of the kings of Israel and Judah, beginning near the end of King David's reign, approximately 3,000 years ago. David's son Solomon has been granted the privilege of overseeing the construction of the temple. Using the finest of materials, the temple is built as a dwelling place for the Ark of the Covenant, which contains God's law as given to Moses. When the day for dedication arrives, leaders, priests, and people gather. The ark with its two stone tablets is put into place. Solomon honors God's fulfillment of his promises and then begins to pray. 1 Kings chapter 8, 22 to 30, and then 41 to 43, begins on page 387 of the Old Testament portion of your Bibles. Hear these words of the prayer. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands to heaven. He said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and steadfast love for your servants who walk before you with all their heart, the covenant that you kept for your servant, my father David, as you declared to him. You promise with your mouth and have this day fulfilled with your hand. Therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant, my father David, that which you promised him, saying, There shall never fail you a successor before me to sit on the throne of Israel, if only your children look to their way, to walk before me as you have walked before me. Therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you promised to your servant, my father David. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Even heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you, much less this house I have built. Regard your servant's prayer and his plea, O Lord my God, heeding the cry and the prayer that your servant prays to you today, that your eyes may be open night and day toward this house, the place of which you said, My name shall be there, that you may heed the prayer that your servant prays toward this place. Hear the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray toward this place. O, hear in heaven your dwelling place, heed and forgive. Likewise, when a foreigner who is not of your people Israel comes from a distant land because of your name, for they shall hear of your great name, your mighty hand, and your outstretched arm, when a foreigner comes and prays toward this house, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, and do according to all that the foreigner calls to you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and so that they may know that your name has been invoked on this house that I have built.
I recently had a conversation with my grandson about prayer. At least that's what I think the conversation was about. It was day 3 of Vacation Bible Camp. Vinny is 5 years old, and this was his second year to take part in VBC. We were on our way to church, and from his car seat behind me, over my right shoulder, he asked, "Is God real?" "Yes," I answered. "Really, really real?" he asked. This told me he had been paying attention to the opening sessions that introduced each day's Vacation Bible Camp themes. The curriculum was trying to help kids learn to distinguish between what is real and what is imitation or not real. Discerning the difference between real and not real is a significant challenge for all of us in the world today. And so the effort to affirm that God is real and not a pretend figure or a cartoon character seemed admirable. "Yes," I said, "God is really, really real." "Well," he mused, "I've been thinking a lot about candy, and I don't have any." I took this to mean that if God was really real, God would have noticed Vinny's desire for candy and materialized some. I felt a little bit defensive on God's behalf. "God's not a candy dispenser," I said. "We pray for things like courage and guidance and comfort." "Oh," Vinny replied, I didn't know. Somehow sounding a little bit embarrassed, like he had misunderstood something he was supposed to be learning. But also maybe that, well, now that things were clarified, we had reached the end of the discussion. And then about 3 seconds later, a strange thing happened. "Actually," I blurted out, "you do have candy." I had just that very moment remembered a partially consumed bag of Skittles, which I had seen at the bottom of his backpack when I had packed the snacks and supplies for the day. I glanced over my shoulder again to confirm that I actually had remembered to put the backpack in the car, and then I told him about the Skittles. "Your mom must have purchased the Skittles for the plane trip," I hypothesized, recalling how my daughter has always believed that Skittles are an excellent antidote to motion sickness. That's a whole other story. "You can eat a couple of Skittles when we get to church, and we'll save the rest for after lunch," I offered. And then I could not resist speculating aloud. Maybe that is the way God answers prayer. God helps us to remember what we already have. We pulled into the parking lot here and got out of the car. We found that mushed up red bag at the bottom of the backpack. Vinny ate 3 Skittles. All smiles, he raced toward the sanctuary for another fun day of Vacation Bible Camp. 4 weeks later, I remain impressed by the mysterious nature of prayer, as well as by my inadequacy when it comes to explaining anything about it. Today, I'm glad that we can look to the wise and wonderful King Solomon for some insight about prayer and an example of when and where and how and why it could be done. Solomon was fortunate to step into royal leadership during a time of relative peace. Whether peace arrived because the superpowers to the north and the south of the little kingdom of Israel had exhausted themselves and were taking a break from fighting, or because King David had been victorious in battle over his more local enemies, or both, David's son Solomon benefited from the opportunity to focus on something other than defending his people and the land they lived on. High priority on his agenda was building a temple, also referred to as a house, to honor God. The house would serve as a fixed dwelling place for the items that symbolized the people's relationship with God. Previously, the stone tablets inscribed with the laws given to Moses had traveled with the people when they traveled. They were carried in a box and protected with a tent. Now, they were going to be located in a building as strong and beautiful as anything that could be imagined. The people were no longer wandering in the wilderness. They had found a home. The temple would make visible this reality. It would testify to their gratitude and their loyalty to the Lord their God. The construction project involved a wide array and a huge number of workers and artisans who labored for several years. You could read a detailed description, if you wish, about this process in chapters 5, 6, and 7 of the book of the Bible called 1 Kings. When the project was finally completed, a dedication ceremony was held. A massive crowd was gathered, including dignitaries, leaders of all the tribes, the priests, the people. Solomon made a short speech reminding people of the history of this dream of building a house for the name of the Lord, and noting that now this long-held dream had been accomplished. His speech was short, and then he began to pray. The prayer actually is quite long. Deborah read portions for us. And the text specifies that to begin, Solomon stood before the newly completed altar in the presence of all the assembled people, stretched out his hands, and spoke aloud. He addressed God and was apparently willing, even eager, that anyone near enough to hear would listen. Thanks to the gifts of writing and record keeping and copying and preserving and publishing, we, all these centuries later, are among those still in a position to hear. We have the opportunity to consider what we learn from listening to Solomon's prayer. The first thing I notice is that apparently Solomon and my grandson, Vinny, agree on the importance of understanding something about the God to whom we are praying. Vinny wanted to be sure that God is really real. Solomon wanted to celebrate and honor that God is unique. There is no God like you in heaven or on earth, he said. God is lovingly faithful to God's devoted people. You keep covenant with your servants who walk before you with all their heart, Solomon affirmed. And God fulfills God's promises. You promise with your mouth and complete with your hand, he observed. Furthermore, Solomon was careful to make clear that he understood God's magnitude. I have no expectation that you'll be confined to living within this house I built, he said. I know that not even the height and the depth of all the heavens could contain you. Solomon was addressing God who is more and bigger and beyond what we humans can even imagine. And yet, Solomon was confident enough of God's presence and trusting enough of God's goodwill to ask for God's attention and God's grace. When he prayed for God's eyes to be open night and day toward this house, and God's ears to hear the plea of the people when they pray toward this place, he was using analogies from our human experience of sight and sound. He used those analogies by way of requesting that God's vigilance and compassion would be extended toward all the people who had God's name in mind when they prayed for forgiveness, or they prayed for help attaining justice, security, nourishment, good health, and whatever other needs they might have. As Solomon's prayer goes on, and I encourage you to read verses 31 through 40 sometime later today or this week, he speaks to people who might come before the altar in God's house, or who might turn toward God and pray and plead in the house, or pray toward the house, or stretch out their hands in the direction of the house. He's picturing people farther and farther and farther away, as well as within this house for God's name. And in all these instances, Solomon describes God as being in heaven and asks that God would hear and respond. Heaven is evidently a place not visible to us, but perhaps quite close, at least close enough that we are within God's hearing distance. In the course of Solomon's prayer, it becomes clear that Solomon's hope and desire is that the house for God's name, which has been built at great expense to the kingdom and great sacrifice on the part of all the workers, this house for God's name would be a facilitator for communication between God and God's people. The construction effort has been intended not only to express gratitude and convey honor, but also to be a visible testimony to what Solomon understands about God. God is entirely reliable, and God has the power to give and sustain life. Solomon wants the house, with its inner sanctuary, sheltering the physical representation of the covenant between God and God's people, to serve as an invitation to a relationship with God. He wants it to be a focal point for prayer, a facilitator of possibility for people to establish a connection with God who loves and cares for them. Ideally, our own house of worship functions in a similar way. We come here to Rolling Hills United Methodist Church, among other things, in order to pray. Over time, the sanctuary, the labyrinth, the meditation garden, maybe even the social hall, become associated in our minds and hearts with prayer. Coming here in person can enhance our ability to pray. So can our memories of being here. So can the sights and sounds of being here when we get online to participate in worship. So can a glimpse of the church as we drive by on Crenshaw. The existence of the church, its beauty, its openness, its peacefulness, the hope and faith of the people who gather, all serve to increase and enhance our ability to pray. It isn't that God is here and nowhere else. It's that God, being uncontainable, is everywhere. And the building helps remind us that we are always welcome, no matter our location, to speak to God with complete honesty about whatever it is that concerns us. As we do so, we put our trust in God's willingness to guide us in the way that leads to life. Solomon's conception of prayer is that God is everywhere, and so we can pray anywhere, as long as our hearts and minds are oriented toward God. He meant for the building he had built to help with that orientation. The other thing I notice as we observe Solomon's practice of prayer is that everybody is meant to be able to do it. Anybody is welcome to begin a conversation with God. You don't have to belong to a specific group of people. You do not have to speak a particular language. You do not have to possess a certain pedigree or credential or life experience. I'm going to go out on a limb and say you don't even have to be a grown-up. You could be a curious child or a befuddled grandma. Solomon has no doubt that people who do not yet know God are going to hear about God's grace and power. As the last section of today's reading indicates, Solomon expects that even foreigners, that's the word he chose that made sense at the time, even foreigners to be able to address and receive a generous response. King Solomon's prayer is an early example of a type of prayer that we still practice today, and Nancy led us through it for today's experience. It happens every week when we worship. We call it intercessory prayer. It means prayers on behalf of other people. Solomon goes through this prayer thinking of people who have done wrong, people who have lost in battle, people who are suffering, drought, famine, plague, sickness, isolation, people who are fighting to survive, people who are in captivity. He imagines all of them praying in and toward the building which represents God's presence, and he urges God to respond in ways that would be helpful, encouraging, and appropriate, depending on the situation and the persons involved. Prayer is for all people, and no topic seems to be off limits. In the face of Solomon's thoroughness and confidence, who am I to say that God would not use or view a child's wish for candy as an opening for dialogue? A dialogue that might eventually help everyone involved to move toward greater comprehension of God's purposes, God's steadfast love, and God's faithfulness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Amen. We're going to conclude our worship with a wonderful hymn, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise. The three verses are printed in your program. You are welcome to rise as we sing, and you can stand or sit, whatever is most comfortable for you. We go forth now, confident of the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, the healing and hope of the Holy Spirit. We go in peace. Amen.